Prince of Praise, Byron Cage, with the beer. Come on.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and everything that's within me. Come on. I will bless his name. Is there anybody in this place that is here to bless him? Let me hear you make some noise. Come on. Here we go. Set. Magnify.
Brothers and sisters, bless the Lord at all times. Welcome to another episode of God's Glory and His Story. I'm your host, MC NME. Put them blessed hands together. Welcome to True Sabbath Fellowship. This is going to be released on October 27th. It's 21 days after the new moon. It is a Sabbath. Welcome to Sabbath Fellowship, brothers and sisters. Welcome. Here on this channel, it's the history that you need because Yahshua did bleed. All the rest will come when he comes on his steed. Don't forget the prayer of Paul to the Ephesians, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 16 through 21. If you read it, it will bless you with understanding of God's word and his love for you. If you haven't done so yet, or you are new to this channel, we ask that you download at least 2 Bible apps. We want you to follow along, and we ask that you make one of those Bible apps the 1611 King James Bible with the Apocrypha. There are extra books in there that you will not get on a standard version of the Bible. And the reason why we say at least 2 Bible apps is right in the middle of your screen. The facts of every case must be established by the testimony of 2 or 3 witnesses. All right, today's episode, brothers and sisters, is Fast and Furious. That's right. It's a play on words as normal, but you're going to see where we're going someplace. All right, when you do a proper fast, God's pace becomes furious. Ooh, let's get to work. Now, brothers and sisters, if you have been following me the last few weeks on this channel, you know I was going through some things where I had to make a life-changing decision. And I'm just so pleased to say that I stood on the side of obedience. I fasted and I prayed, and the Lord came through just like he said he would in his word. So why should we fast? So I got 8 things here. Expectancy. It's a statute forever. Protection. Healing. Deliverance. Repentance. Redemption. And spiritual warfare. We're going to touch on each one of these today. So you get a good understanding of why we should fast and what fasting is all about. So healing. Fasting is a form of humbling yourself so that the healing can take place. 1611 King James Bible, 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verses 12 through 16. Some of this is going to be a familiar verse of passage, but I expanded a little bit so you can get more context. It is written, "And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for an house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locust to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land. Now my eyes shall be open and mine ears attent to the prayers that is made in this place. For now I have chosen and sanctified this house that my name may be there forever, and mine eyes and mine heart shall be there perpetually." So you see, he said, humble thyself and pray and seek my face and turn from wicked ways. So you got to do those four things. So prayer is one of them, and humbling yourself is another. So when we say humble ourselves, we're going to see what we're talking about. Let's move on to spiritual warfare. Now, you've heard the saying, you don't bring a knife to a gunfight. Well, likewise, you don't bring the flesh to a spiritual fight. 1611 King James Bible, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 6. It is written, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ, and having in a readiness to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled." Expectancy. Yahshua himself expects you to fast, just like he expects you to pray. 1611 King James Bible, Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 and 6, and then verse 16 through 18. It is written, and is his words, "And when thou prayest, thou shalt not be as the hypocrites are, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily, I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father, which is in secret, and thy Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly." So you can see just from those scriptures, he says, when you pray, don't do this, but when you pray, do this. So he's telling you, he's showing you that he expects you to pray. Well, that same cadence was brought forth when he talked about fasting. Verse 16, "Moreover, when ye fast, be not as the hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily, I say unto you, they have their reward. But thou, when thou fastest, anointeth thine head and wash thy face, that thou appear not unto men to fast, but unto thy Father, which is in secret. And thy Father, which seeth in secret, shall reward thee openly. So there's an expectancy, just like he expects you to pray for yourself and your family, and it tells you, the word tells you to pray without ceasing. He expects you to fast. I'm just learning this myself, brothers and sisters. I never really knew much about fasting, but I undertook this fast during this time of making that life-changing decision. And I'm speaking from experience. He came through just like he said he would. More on why we should fast. It's a statute forever. It's part of the law that is written by human, but has the standing of a commandment, which was written by God himself on the tablets. 1611 King James Bible, Leviticus chapter 16, verses 8 through 10, and then 29 through 31. It is written, and Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other lot for the scapegoat. And Aaron shall bring the goat upon which the Lord's lot fell and offer him for a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord to make an atonement with him and to let him go for a scapegoat into the wilderness. And this shall be a statute forever unto you, that in the seventh month, on the tenth day of the month, ye shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, whether it be one of your own country or a stranger that sojourneth among you. For on that day shall the priest make an atonement for you to cleanse you, that ye may be clean from all your sins before the Lord. It shall be a Sabbath of rest unto you, and ye shall afflict your souls by a statute forever. Wow. So what does he mean when he says afflict your soul? So the Hebrew word for afflict is anah. Don't know if I'm pronouncing that correct, but that does kind of sound like something we would say, anah, man. But anyway, anah, which is always translated in connection with Yom Kippur as meaning to fast. Strong concordance shows many other meanings, such as abase self, deal hardly with. Here's the key one, humble, ravish, and the Hebrew and Aramaic lexicon of the Old Testament says it means to be wretched or emaciated. Now, there's some other words in there that we could actually go and look up for definitions, but I wanted to get that word humble. That word humble is in there. It's to humble. A fast is humbling yourself. So that would be what they say, afflict your soul. So the new moon of June, because they said it was the 10th month, right? We have to count back, and then the 10th month says plus 10 days, then you have the Day of Atonement. So it would have been the new moon of June, or Tammuz, plus 10 days. That is the Day of Atonement. that we should actually be recognizing, because it says it is forever. Now, some are going to say, oh, that's for the Jews. It's for the Yahudi. It's for the Israelites. It was Israelites back then. There was no J. There was no word term Jew. So another reason why we should fast, for protection. It can provide safe passage. 1611 King James Bible, Ezra chapter 8, verses 21 through 23. It is written, then I proclaimed a fast there at the river of Ahava, that we might afflict ourselves before our God, to seek of him a right way for us and for our little ones and for all our substance. For I was ashamed to require of the king a band of soldiers and horsemen to help us against the enemy in the way, because we had spoken unto the king, saying, the hand of our God is upon all them for good that seek him. But his power and his wrath is against all them that forsake him. So we fasted and besought our God for this, and he was entreated of us. See, Ezra had just got the okay to go back to the land of Israel or Jerusalem to start to rebuild the second temple. And instead of him asking the king for protection, he decided to put on a fast and ask the Lord. Another reason why we should fast, for deliverance. For this, we go to the book of Esther, chapter 4, verses 14 through 16, 1611 King James Bible. It is written, for if thou altogether holdest thy peace at this time, then shall their enlargement and deliverance arise to the Jews from another place. But if thou and thy father's house shall be destroyed, and who knoweth whether thou art come to the kingdom for such a time as this. Then Esther bade them return to Mordecai this answer. Go, gather together all the Yahudi that there are present in Shushan, and fast ye for me, and neither eat nor drink 3 days, night or day. I also and my maidens will fast likewise, and so will I go in unto the king, which is not according to the law. And if I perish, I perish. So those who don't know the story, Esther was a Yahudi princess, and she was asked to, there was a law that went out, decree going out to kill all the Jewish people or the Yahudis. And Esther, being a Yahudi herself, as a queen, she had the king's ear, but you couldn't approach the king unless he called for you. So this is what she was asking for the fast for, because she was going to approach the king without being called. And that's what she meant by, if I perish, I perish. And just as a side note, her name was Hadass. That's her Hebrew name. Esther was the name that was given to her. Another reason why we should fast, for repentance. For that, we go to 1611 King James Bible, 1 Kings chapter 21, verses 25 through 29. It is written, but there was none like unto Ahab, which did sell himself to work wickedness in the sight of the Lord, whom Jezebel, his wife, stirred up. And he did very abominably in following idols, according to all things as did the Amorites, whom the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. And it came to pass, when Ahab heard those words, that he rent his clothes and put sackcloth upon his flesh and fasted and lay in sackcloth and went softly. And the Lord of the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, "Seest thou how Ahab humbleth himself before me? Because he humbleth himself before me, I will not bring the evil in his days, but in his son's days will I bring the evil upon his house." Another reason to fast for redemption. New Living Translation, Joel chapter 2, verses 12 through 17, 25 through 27, and 29 through 32. It is written, "That is why the Lord says, turn to me now while there is time. Give me your hearts. Come with fasting, weeping, and mourning. Don't tear your clothes in your grief, but tear your hearts instead. Return to the Lord your God, for he is merciful and compassionate, slow to get angry, and filled with unfailing love. He's eager to relent and not punish. Who knows? Perhaps he will give you a reprieve, sending you a blessing instead of this curse. Perhaps you will be able to offer grain and wine to the Lord your God as before. Blow the ram's horn in Jerusalem. Announce a time of fasting. Call the people together for a solemn meeting. Gather all the people, the elders, the children, even the babies. Call the bridegroom from his quarters and the bride from her private room. Let the priests who minister in the Lord's presence stand and weep between the entry room to the temple and the altar. Let them pray, 'Spare your people, Lord. Don't let your special possession become an object of mockery. Don't let them become a joke for unbelieving foreigners who say, has the God of Israel left them?' The Lord says, 'I will give you back what you lost to the swarming locust, the hopping locust, the stripping locust, and the cutting locust. It was I who sent this great destroying army against you. Once again, you will have all the food you want, and you will praise the Lord your God, who does these miracles for you. Never again will my people be disgraced. Then you will know that I am among my people Israel, that I am the Lord your God, and there is no other. Never again will my people be disgraced. In those days, I will pour out my spirit, even on servants, men and women alike, and I will cause wonders in the heavens and on the earth, blood and fire and columns of smoke. And the sun will become dark, and the moon will turn blood red before that great and terrible day of the Lord arrives. But everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. For some on Mount Zion in Jerusalem will escape, just as the Lord had said. These will be among the survivors whom the Lord has called." All right, brothers and sisters, it's that time. Any of those of you who feel that you know it's time to give your life to the Lord, here's a suggested prayer for you. You can pause the episode right here and say that prayer with sincerity in your heart. And if you do so, I'd like to be the first to welcome you to the family. But I don't make offerings here. So here's what you would need to do after reading that prayer. Read your Bible daily. And I know as people say they don't know how to read the Bible, where to start. Go back, watch my episode number 62. It's called "You're His Story" on this channel. It will guide you, tell you how to break down and read the Bible so that it makes sense. Next, find a Bible-based place with like-minded believers, a place that you can grow. This place must feed your spirit and your mind, not just a place you simply go just to be there. No, a place that you can grow. And then the third thing you must do is to pray without ceasing. It means to seek the Lord your God for all things. Remember the cap for Christ at 12:34 Eastern Standard Time, AM and PM. Set your phones. It's an obscure number you will forget. Set your phones. All we ask is for 60 seconds of meditation, which you simply saying kumbaya, kumbaya. Out loud if you're in private, or simply to yourself, bowing your head, closing your eyes, 60 seconds. It's about speaking with that one voice. Let that voice get louder and louder. All right, you remember you can catch me on Facebook, Hebrew Connect, YouTube, and we have just added another channel. We are now going to be on Rumble as well. So you can catch us on Rumble now. If you like this episode, give it a thumbs up, but more important that you share this with others. And if you haven't done so yet, we ask that you consider subscribing to this channel. If you're on Facebook, we ask that you follow us on Facebook, but the other channels, you can simply subscribe. Email address is right in the middle of your screen, or you can drop me a line in the comments. I'd love to hear from you guys. All right, may the Lord and Savior grant you his peace that surpasses all understanding. May it rest, rule, and abide with you now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen. Love you guys. Appreciate you guys. See you next time. Peace. Never change.